Has this ever happened to you? You put some money in a savings account with a great rate. But that promotional savings rate came crashing down. You deserve better. Take just 5 minutes and open a Capital One savings account online. You'll get one of the nation's best rates that's not a promotional rate. Welcome to Banking Reimagined. What's in your wallet?
For consumers only. Offered by Capital One N.A. member FDIC. Copyright 2017 Capital One.
Blog Talk Radio.
Hi, my name is Stephen Knight, and you're listening to The Stephen Knight Show.
You came here to party, go on, put your hands up. If you want to get it started, go on, put your hands up. All my ladies in the front, all my thugs in the club. If you're looking for some love, go on, put your hands up. Hands up, hands up, hands up, hands up. If you came here to party, go on, put your hands up. All my ladies in the front, all my thugs in the club. If you're looking for some love, go on, put your hands up.
Good evening and welcome to the Stephen Knight Show here on EOTM Radio. I want to thank each of you for joining us tonight. As always, we'll be discussing the latest in entertainment news, sports, fashion, and movie reviews. Now, tonight we welcome two talented artists that were featured on the first season of Fox hit show Empire. Corr Kendricks and Bozeman will join us to talk about their music and appearing on the show. As always, I want you to call into your questions and comments. The number is 267-521-0189. Again, that's 267-521-0189. You can also join us in chat. There's a link on our Facebook page. I want to remind you, we're all over social media, Facebook, Twitter, Google+, Instagram, and, of course, our official website, thestephenknightshow.com. Connect with us. Email us at submissions@thestephenknightshow.com and let us know your thoughts. Now, Ms. Parker is out tonight. She had death in the family, so our thoughts and prayers with her. Ms. Ferguson, busy scheduling. She has a mother on the way, about to be a mother, expected mother, so she's out. And then Aaron is visiting family back home in West Virginia. So me, Adam, and Chica are going to hold it down tonight. Speaking of, so how you doing, Chica?
I'm doing well, brother. How are you?
I'm good. Adam, I know you're on. How you doing?
I'm doing pretty good. It's Monday, so, you know.
It's Monday. How was everyone's weekend?
Good. Relaxing. Hot.
Take the words out of my mouth. Very hot and very relaxing.
Very hot. Yeah. Mine was very hot, but it was a good weekend.
I'm sorry. Okay.
I'm sorry.
Yeah, he said, how hot does it get up there?
We were in the 90s, and, you know, with the heat, you know, comes the thunderstorms. So it was like on and off rain over the weekend. I actually was working out on Saturday. I ride my bike aggressively, and I was out on my aggressive bike ride, and it started thunderstorming in the middle of my workout, which was pretty interesting. You know, I raced home because I thought I was going to get struck by lightning. No fun.
That actually happened to me too, Chicky. That actually happened to me. I was after I finished my weights, I went outside to run the stairs because it had kind of cooled down a little bit. And then I started feeling a couple raindrops. I got in my car. I mean, it stormed, wind was blowing. It was crazy. And I was stuck in the traffic going home, but then only lasted like 20 minutes and then it was dry again. And Adam, did you experience that? I know a lot of people didn't experience that in Atlanta. They experienced the crazy weather.
Yeah, rain. I had it around here. Yeah, it was super heavy for a really quick amount of time. And then, like you said,
right,
it just all disappeared and it was like nothing happened and it was still hot.
Exactly. Yeah, that's crazy. So anyway, what's going on in the wonderful world of movies?
Well, Pixar, with their movie Inside Out, had the highest opening of any Pixar movie in the past. This past weekend with $91 million box office. Unfortunately, that was not enough to beat the dinosaurs. So Jurassic World got 101 or 102 million this past weekend. It's on a huge roll. And this is actually the first time that Pixar's movies have not had an opening weekend as number one since Toy Story. So this is it's a big deal, but it's not you know, the dinosaurs are still big. Everyone loving Jurassic World. They're still going out to see it. You know, Pixar has nothing to be worried about because they had their largest opening ever too. But yeah, it's definitely been a kind of a summer blockbuster weekend this past weekend with a lot of people going out to the theaters.
Yeah, yeah. And it's, I think it's good that people are going, because I know movie sales had declined significantly, and you know, they attribute to a lot of the price and everything, but it seems like people are back in the movies again.
Yeah, and it might be just to avoid the heat, but whatever they're doing, it's
right.
Working. So.
That is true.
It's definitely,
kids are out of school. Kids are out of school,
yep.
You know what I mean? Yeah.
And it,
exactly.
And it is a
right.
Different kind of movie season during the summer anyway. If you notice, the different types of movies come out over the summer. It's starting at spring through the summer. And then remember that lull that we had after the Oscars where not too many decent films were coming out? That's kind of the trend now with movies. They really hot in the summer, then they start to cool down in the fall. You get more intense drama content like from maybe September on until December, the Christmas season, and then there's a lull.
Exactly. So we're ramping up. And I did I did end up seeing Inside Out. I saw Jurassic World, and I missed last weekend. And as I mentioned, it was good. It is definitely a movie for the new generation. You know, if you saw the original, it's not as good, I don't think, as the original, but it's entertaining enough. You'll enjoy it. New kids will enjoy this kind of the whole action, not too much depth, but it's a good adventure. And, you know, the numbers don't lie as having the biggest opening weekend of any movie so far. So it was good in that aspect. Now, Inside Out, I thought was really good. And it's kind of a weird story. I didn't understand, you know, when Pixar pitched it. It follows this girl's five emotions that all live inside her brain, and they're all different characters. So you got sadness, anger, fear, joy, and jealousy. And, or I guess jealousy is how they termed it. But, you know, they're living inside her brain. They kind of give you what her different thought process is, and then they move. The family moves to a new city, and that kind of scrambles everything. So it's a great story, great adventure. You know, the story could be a little complicated, but adults will enjoy it. Kids will enjoy it. Yeah, I'm actually, you know, this is probably one of my favorite Pixar movies in a long time, because usually to me, some are kind of just, they're good for the kids, but then you move on and see other things. So highly recommend
right.
that one.
I heard good things about that movie. I heard, now one of my friends, going back to Jurassic World, he said that the movie, the graphics were great, but the storyline wasn't that good. What
correct.
Do you
I
think
mean,
about
it's
that?
It's not a lot of substance.
Yeah.
It's, you know, you're watching action,
yeah.
You're watching the characters do their thing. They're not diving too deep into the backgrounds of anyone. But
right.
It's fine. I think people are kind of expecting this to be, again, the kind of the Jurassic movie for the new kids, the new ones that are going to watch it and enjoy the action.
Right. Okay. Chikes?
I actually saw the feature film Dope from writer-director Rick Famuyiwa. And it's reminiscent of House Party, Sunset Park. It's a dramedy. There are moments where you're like peeing in your pants laughing, and then there are moments where, you know, you well up and you want to cry. In all honesty, it's the best movie I've seen this year. You know how I am about stories and content. The story takes you on a journey. It's about three geeks who actually turn gangster. And the way that the story unfolds, it takes you on this journey of the main character, who's a young African-American, if you can follow me. He's African, but he's African-American. And he is on his way out of high school, getting ready to go into college. And he's a geek, but he lives in the hood in Inglewood, California. And circumstances put him in a situation where he's thrown into the drug game. And it's very interesting how he weaves himself through his dilemma with his two friends. It's very, very interesting. It stars Zoe Kravitz. Shameik Moore actually plays the lead character. And A$AP Rocky makes an appearance. Quincy, if anyone's familiar who Quincy is, that's Albie Shore's son, who turned actor, is also featured in the movie. And the movie is actually produced by Pharrell, and it's put out by Revolt Films, which is P. Diddy's movie company. So right. I definitely recommend this one. I walked away pleasantly surprised and pleased. It gave me exactly what I want from Hollywood. Exactly.
Nice. Well, I do want to see that movie. Oh.
I'm sorry.
What was it called again?
The name of the movie is called Dope. And ironically, the movie, the way the movie starts, it actually brings up the word dope and it gives you the different definitions of dope. And the movie encompasses all of those definitions.
Oh, nice.
Interesting.
I did want to see that movie. So my issue, well, it's not really an issue, but they didn't market it well is my problem. Because when you watch the trailers on TV, you don't know what the movie's about. Like, actually, I had to look it up because the trailers, I mean, again, maybe I only saw different trailers, but I don't feel like they gave you any of the plot in the trailer or any of the storyline. And only once I read about it online and saw, like you said, kind of that turn of events that now he's has to be a drug dealer or whatever, you're like, oh, this actually looks interesting. And I know it did really well at Sundance, but I don't know who was in charge of marketing, but I don't think they did a good job of kind of giving you the full story.
And I agree with you. But this is what I'm with Sherlock Holmes on this, and this is what I suspect happened. I suspect that the movie came out and they did a screening, and maybe they've done, because a lot of people in Hollywood do special screenings where they want investors to come in to watch the movie. And I think that Pharrell and Puffy and them came in after the fact. And maybe they didn't have that time frame to do the marketing that they would do if it was done the other way. So I think that they came in on the back end to help give it a push with their name and, of course, their money.
Yeah, well, that's good, and I hope it does pick up because I know it had a smaller opening this weekend. But, again, they didn't like the marketing. You don't know what the movie's about, and you know how tough it is these days to spend $10 on a movie that you don't know what it's about. So,
exactly.
I hope it does pick up, especially because to me, there's nothing next weekend that looks exciting. I mean, there's Ted 2, but I'm not it's just a sequel again. So I'm going to be hunting for something original. So I'm hoping over the next couple of weeks it does pick up in the audience and word of mouth kind of brings it in.
Yeah, I'm thinking that once word of mouth goes around about how good this movie is, it will pick up the next weekend. It grossed $6.1 million this weekend. I actually went to one of the newer theaters here, and they redid it. You know, I don't know if you've been to any of the newer theaters with AMC, but they redesigned the seat.
The recliner.
Oh, that's a beautiful thing.
Oh, yeah.
But what I did not appreciate about the theater was that it was assigned seating, like as if you were going to a concert. So, when you went to go buy, when I went to go buy my ticket, she showed me a chart and she said, where do you want to sit? So I went with a group of people and so the movie was almost sold out. I think it was like four seats left and we could not sit with each other. I thought that sucked. But after I got in the movie and I sat in the seat, I was like, well, I don't need to sit next to them anyway. And then when the movie came on, I forgot that I came with people. So that was
good. Yeah, and the recliners are so comfortable that you don't
really
think about it.
They really, really are.
Yeah, same thing happened to me.
Fall asleep.
You're right. And that would put me to sleep, so I can't lay back too far. But I will say that I did have that famous bird she came with the assigned seating when I went to they opened another theater out here. Atlantic Station has a movie theater, and they added a VIP area, whatever, where they had the recliner and you get food and drinks and stuff like that. And, yeah, I didn't like the assigned seat. I didn't like that.
No, I don't like it either because you're punishing people for being on time. I'm on time for the movie, and people purchase their tickets maybe online or maybe even the day before. So they give them preferential seating, but you're not showing up until, like, after the previews come off. I'm already reclined in my seat, and I can't sit where I want to, and you're walking in front of me. Like, it's fake.
Yeah. I will admit, it's a weird trend. I think once you start doing it, you'll get used to it because there are certain movies that come out and you do want to buy online, and it's kind of, I guess, pushing less people at less, I guess, ticket register people at the box office and more of online. But it is a warning to anyone. It seems like it's going to be a trend with AMC at least on this whole reserve seating. So just keep that in mind. If you're going to any of the new AMC theaters, I'm sure across the country, they're going to probably have a reserve seating. So just check online and see. Fandango, I think, does a good job of telling you if it's reserve seating. when you're looking. So just kind of keep in mind of that as well, because yeah, you don't want a surprise theater and there's hardly any seats left.
Mm-hmm.
Absolutely.
Well, you're on a date and you can't sit with your date.
Yeah, that would be kind of weird. Although I do have a story. I remember a few years ago, I was going on the first date with this girl that I met at Velvet Room. And they always say the movies is not, and I learned the hard way, movies not a good place for a first date. So get to the movie theater, and I don't know if you remember, Adam, that's when they were doing that constructive repaving 85. So we decided to meet at the because I was running late because their trash was horrible. So she said, well, I'll buy the tickets, and you just take care of dinner. I said, that's great. She talked me clean through that movie. Clean through the movie, like loud. We went to go see that movie. What's that movie Will Smith played in when he was the action hero? You remember
Hancock.
He was like the alcoholic?
Hancock.
Oh, yeah, Hancock.
And she loved Will Smith. And I heard about it the whole movie. So maybe it's a good thing to catch up with your date at the movie. Maybe it's a good thing to catch up with your date at the movie. Anyway, enough about that. So, anything coming up? I know you said, you know, it seems like the big movies are out now.
Well, 4th of July week is Terminator, of course, another sequel.
Mm-hmm.
I'm on the fence about it. I'll probably see it just to get a kind of an idea of what it is. But they're bringing Arnold back. So, and it does star the main character, the girl from Game of Thrones, the Dragon Girl. If you're a Game of Thrones fan, she is the main character in this movie as well. But that's the only thing that's really on my radar. Again, it's just kind of seemed like more sequels are coming out for the summer. So
yeah,
we'll see.
I have something to add about Terminator. Maybe it may get more fans to come out and pay a little bit different attention to Terminator. I did not know that the Terminator series was really a prequel to The Matrix. The Terminator series is when the machines, if you remember the first Terminator story.
Skynet.
Yes. It's when the machines first start coming into play. And the Matrix is basically after the machines take over. Something else to think about when you're watching Terminator.
Interesting.
Right.
Interesting. Well, listen, so Aaron's out. I want to hear his reaction to the NBA Finals maybe next week. And, of course, Ms. Ferguson's out. If you want to find her recent finds, go to budgetshopaholic.com. Adam, would you like to stay on for Hot Topics?
Sure.
Okay, great. All right, so first topic. Last week, a 21-year-old, a Caucasian gunman, murdered 9 African-Americans at a Bible study meeting at Historical Emmanuel African Methodist Episcopal Church in Charleston, South Carolina. Allegedly, his reason was he wanted to create a race war. In the wake of overflowing sadness, even amid charges of horrific crimes, there it is, the Confederate flag hanging high above the grounds of the South Carolina Capitol. Now, many believe that the flag is disrespectful and should come down, while others say it's not about race, it's about Southern heritage. What are your thoughts?
Me? Take that shit down. No, it's a joke. So that whole the flag became a big deal during the like the 50s,
civil rights.
And again, mm-hmm. against the civil rights from beginning. So it doesn't have the heritage that people are claiming it has. Texas just rejected it being on license plates. I mean, it's time to move on. You know, Germany has outlawed all swastikas. You can't have it in anything. I don't even think until recently they had it in their movies. So it's common sense. I mean, this is this flag is a pointless fight. Why even try? I mean, I don't know why these people defend it, but it's time to move it down. And as you can see, and I don't know, I don't try to get too much into politics, but definitely the Republicans are trying to jump on the bandwagon of taking it down in South Carolina too.
Mm-hmm.
But I think that's just they're doing it for their political reasons. But yeah, it's time to get that thing down.
Well, it's interesting that you talk about the politics because when they were first asked about a lot of the Republican candidates, when they were asked about the what should South Carolina do, they said it's really up to them. They really don't think it's up their place. But then when the governor of South Carolina, she announced today that she wants it down, all of the Republicans jumped on it.
Mitt Romney was quick to say, yeah, let's get it down.
Yeah, so it was interesting you said that. What are your thoughts, GK?
Mine is kind of a little complicated because I believe in the whole nature of this country that we should be able to express how we feel regardless. It's how you feel.
Mm-hmm.
How you act with the public is totally different. Now, I'm going to be honest. I live in the suburbs. I live in a majority African-American community, and it's a nice community, but we do have other races that live in this community. Down the street and around the corner from me, it's on my workout path, there's a couple that has a home that has a Confederate flag outside their home. They're bold enough to put the flag outside their home knowing where they live. I personally, when I first saw it, it offended me, but that is how you feel. You're from the South. That's how you feel. That's your flag. That doesn't necessarily dictate how you're going to treat me, because I think how you should treat me should be different. It should be based on how my rights should be and what rights say that you should, how you should treat me. I feel like you could do whatever you want as far as what you believe in, but just don't act upon, you know, the negativity of that. Just my thoughts.
I personally think that flag should not be up anywhere. I think that it should be in a museum because it was part of our history. And, because you can't erase history. But having a museum so that people are educated on what it means, and people who are pro the flag, they can discuss their views, and people against it. But, you know, that flag has been used. It's been used so negatively over the years. And
it has.
There's a lot of conversation now because of what happened at the church, but for years it's been talked about, this flag, you know. So that's just my thought. Let's talk about the whole shooting. Oh, I'm sorry. Go ahead, JK.
No, I was just going to say, if you remember years and years and years ago, when we were younger, there used to be a show on television with the Confederate flag on a car, and they were riding it around, and it was all American, and we all loved that show, and it wasn't such a issue back then. But Dukes of Hazzard, if anyone doesn't know, they had it on top
Dukes
of the General
Hazzard,
League.
Yeah. And I love that show, too. Me and my great-grandma used to watch it. Well, let's talk about the sadness, you know, of that of the shooting. You know, 21-year-old man walks into a church, and he sits there with them for an hour during their Bible study. And as they adjourn, he breaks out and shoots and killing 9 people from what I think it was 82 to 26-year-old people who passed away. One lady, the 26-year-old mother, she played dead, covering her granddaughter and laying in her son's blood to pretend that she was dead. The pastor who was murdered, the lead pastor, his wife and 6-year-old child were in the office. They heard the shooting, hid underneath the desk, called 911. The dispatcher told them to stay in there and to stay on the phone, and they were sending people out. Just people, you know, and even when he was detained, he was reportedly told police that he almost didn't do it because everyone was so nice to him. What are your thoughts about this? What would make a person do that?
Well, didn't they say that his father bought him the gun? That was a gift from his father?
His father gave him the money for his birthday.
I'll give him the money.
With that and with some other money he had saved up. But his father also said when it happened, if he could, he would kill him.
Well, you know, that type of demeanor is taught. It's not something that you're born with. So that hatred that he had within himself had to come from his upbringing. So we don't know what the lessons were in his household. We don't know even how his parents were raised. It's been inside of him for a while. He just didn't wake up one day and decide that he was going to do this. That hatred has been there. And I argue if there have been other incidents of violence in other places, maybe in school, maybe somewhere else, maybe in his neighborhood somewhere, I just don't think that was the beginning. Because I don't think that would be your first move to just do that grand of a scale. I just don't think that he would do that for his first time out.
Oddly enough, he had 2 African-American friends. Even on social media, Facebook, he had a lot of black friends. But these guys, they may have been biracial. But one of them, he said he still loves them. The other one said that he knows his parents. His parents did not exude that hatred towards African-Americans. And so, but I thought it was interesting. I had a conversation with a friend yesterday, and he says that he thinks that that he was, even though he's the one that committed the act, there were people behind it. He doesn't think he acted alone, because to do what you did is such a, you know, you researched the church, you knew it was a historical church. It's kind of like he kind of attributed to, you know, when the people overseas, what in Iraq, Al-Qaeda, when Al-Qaeda, you know, how they will do the suicide attacks. He thinks that this guy was a product of that in the, you know, against blacks. I thought that was interesting because the fact that he has no history with his family of being that kind of way, you know, that, and even the fact that he said that he almost didn't do it because everyone was so nice, but he knew that was his mission. I thought that was kind of interesting. I don't know. And even the fact that he left one of the people alive to tell the story because he knew he had to die. He told one of the ladies, he asked her, did I shoot you? She said no. He said, good, because one of us has to be here to tell what's going to happen. I'm about to kill myself. And he didn't, supposedly, because he ran out of ammunition. So I don't know. There's a lot to it. What were you about to say, Adam?
You actually brought up what I was thinking. You know, it is who is, you know, and especially in the Middle East, who's behind these suicide bombers. It's not the person alone.
Mm-hmm.
You know, they're not bred, but they're brainwashed, I guess, in a sense, to do what they have to do. And this guy, I mean, it sounds like he almost had a change of heart. I agree with what your friend was saying, that there was something behind it. Because, again, these suicide bombers, I mean, no one in their right mind is going to just go kill themselves. But when they're around people who encourage them or, you know, kind of get them all in that mentality, then, you know, they're going to fight or they're going to do whatever. And it happens way too often in the Middle East. I'm sure, you know, every other day there's a suicide bomber. And I mean, it's definitely someone used them as a pawn. And he followed through. It's crazy.
It actually reminds me of Higher Learning. Do you remember Higher Learning? The movie where the guy's on campus and he does that mass shooting, it was derived of him being initiated into the group, and they hyped him up to actually do that, and then he too was going to kill himself.
Did he end up doing it in the movie?
No, ran out of ammunition.
Okay. Wow. This, it does remind me, and sorry to go to another movie. There was a Palestinian movie released probably about 10 years ago. And it was about these two brothers, and one was committed to being a suicide bomber. And so he was just planning his trips, and he was kind of going back and forth into Israel, you know, into the checkpoints, and he was passing, you know, whatever. He's going through that, just doing his trials. And then he meets this girl who's a Palestinian. And she has a different idea. She said, you know, we don't have to do this through violence. So she kind of, in the end, she convinces him not to do it. And his brother, who was against it at first, something happens tragically. So he's convinced to do it. And then in the end, the brother does it. And it's kind of tragic. But again, it's these people that are just being told to do something. Again, pawns for these kind of incidents.
Yeah. Yeah, it's sad, but our thoughts and prayers are definitely with the people of South Carolina and everyone else affected by the shooting, and even his family. You know, they talked about his family. I know the judge who did the arraignment got a lot of pushback because he reminded everyone that the young man's family, they were being affected by this. They said just generally because judges aren't supposed to do that. They're supposed to, you know, come in here, handle their business, not give a speech, you know, about either side. But he has some issues with him anyway from previously. But anyway, but I do think that his family, you know, we should definitely keep them in our thoughts and prayers as well, but especially the members of that church. And but I will say this, you know, watching the coverage, I like that, you know, he wanted to create a race war, but yet it seemed like everyone came and unified together. You know, if you looked at that church from the service on Sunday, it was black, white, you know, just the whole community coming together, and I like that. So hopefully a bigger discussion, you know, starts and you know, things kind of heal in this city. But let's switch gears real quick. So the Daily Star is reporting that Marvel Studios wants singer and part-time actress Beyonce Knowles to join the Avengers. They said, "We would love to have Beyonce on board, almost certainly as a newcomer to the screen from Marvel's existing catalog, comic book characters." It says Marvel's Avengers Infinity War Part 1 is slated to start in IMAX theaters May 4th, 2018, and Part 2 will open May 3rd, 2019. Question is, would you like to see Beyonce part of the Avengers?
No. I understand that this woman is a cash cow. She brings in money for everybody. I get it. Do not mess with the brand. Please, let Beyonce be Beyonce. Marvel Comics be Marvel Comics. Never the two shall meet. Please don't do that. As a comic book fan from, like, a kid, like, please don't do that. It's one thing. It's one thing. I'm sorry, Adam. It's one thing when you create fanfare from a character and the person becomes famous from a character, i.e., let's look at Linda Carter, who played Wonder Woman for DC. She became a star because of Wonder Woman. I would not mind that, but you have Beyonce, who is an entity all on her own. I think that whatever they put her in would get lost in the Beyonce-ness. I don't think that people would go to pay attention to the story, the character, the plot, none of that. They would be paying attention to Beyonce. And it would be a Beyonce movie, not a Marvel Comics movie.
I agree.
And, I mean, they're making hundreds of millions per movie. How much more do they need? Like, what other audience can they reach? I think they can hit every audience age range and gender and race and everything in the world. I don't think they need to really worry about trying to capture the Beyonce crowd.
Right, yeah. I'd have to agree with both of you. All right, last story before we go to music break. Taylor Swift had criticized Apple for not paying artist royalties during the free trial period of the Apple Music streaming service, but Apple now has since agreed to pay royalties to those fans during the three-month trial to their Apple Music after Taylor Swift threatened to withhold her 1989 album from the tech giant's upcoming streaming services. She said that she did this, obviously, you know, she did it for herself, but also she did it for up-and-coming artists who don't have the success or, you know, the platform that she has in terms of her voice and her name. What are your thoughts about Apple kind of caving into Taylor Swift's demands?
Well, first of all, I've listened to the 1989 album, and I am a Taylor Swift fan. I'll admit it, but the album wasn't too impressive, so I think taking the album off wasn't a big loss. But because I think she was being really dramatic when she took everything off Spotify. But I will say that these Apple Music thought they could get away with 3 month subscriptions for free without paying the artists. And I mean, you know, how many credit cards can you put in before you get so many 3 month free subscriptions people can do? So I think it's good that they bowed down to it and are helping the artist. And I think it's good if she has the spokesperson to kind of jump in front and say, let's try to change this. Then I like that, because you do have those small artists that aren't getting paid anything. And if anything, the big artists can do to help, that's a good thing. So when I first heard the story, I thought Taylor was just being dramatic. But now that Apple's actually reversed their decision in like a day, I'm happy that she ended up doing it.
Okay. Chica?
It's that whole thing of indie versus major all over again. And, you know, Felicia Johnson, friend of the show, sister to Selena Johnson, I always quote her, and she says indie is the new major.
Mm-hmm.
Artists are going. You're going to see more artists pulling and reserving their art so they can gain more money for themselves without using major distribution. Major distribution is still the go-to because it's international. Once artists find a way to be international all on their own in the indie sort of way, that's what's going to happen because it cuts out the middleman. It's going to be directly from fan to artist as far as the money flow. It's only going to be a matter of time. When they figure out how to do that without needing those big corporations, that's what they're going to do. And it's slowly but surely getting there. It's just like moves like what Taylor Swift just did. Those little fights and those little battles are going to be the things that take it there. And if you look at the music industry now, you'll see more artists have their own label than 10, even 5 years ago.
Mm-hmm.
It's just a trend. Mm-hmm. It's working toward that.
And, you know, Janet Jackson, she's out with a new single, that we'll be playing later on. But she's out with a new single, and she's announced this new album and this, this world tour. But she's doing it all from her own label now.
Mm-hmm.
You know,
and she's
so
never done
right.
that before.
Go ahead, I'm sorry.
No, I was just saying that she's never done that before. And as big of an artist and as much money as she's made, she's never had her own label. And I'm saying, you know, Prince went through the war of changing his name to a symbol for that reason alone, just so that he can have the rights to his own music.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
I agree. But I am a fan of streaming services. Sorry, just to add a little bit. I am a fan of streaming services. I use Spotify. And, you know, when Taylor had that little battle with Spotify and pulled things, Ed Sheeran came out and he said, you know, that's great for Taylor. She's a big name. But if it wasn't for Spotify, people like me would have never been discovered. So, keep the streaming services for us indie people because people will listen to us even passively and like us. And I'm not a big fan of Apple's music, Apple Music or Beats or whatever they bought to make it what they are. But I am a fan of the streaming sites.
Well, Steven, you're an artist. What do you think about that?
Well, I'm going to say Steven Knight Music is on Spotify, so I love Spotify. But I get what Taylor's trying to say. She's trying to say that, you know, we put in this hard work. It should not be for free. You know, my mother, she always used to tell me, people will pay you what you tell them you're worth. So I get that point. But I think it's, you know, there has to be a fine line. And, you know, you have to know how to take it there without alienating yourself from everything. Because if your music is nowhere to be found, it's not going to get bought anyway. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
You know, she can take that risk because she's such a big name, but every artist can't do that. They need Spotify. They need these streaming services.
Pandora,
so that their song happens to come on. Oh, I didn't know this person had this song. You know what I mean? So I definitely see both ends, but I do give, you know, shout out to Taylor Swift for speaking up. You know, using her name because she can afford to take that hit. You know, I couldn't afford to take that hit if I spoke out. No one cared anyway. They'd be like, Stephen, but Taylor Swift, she can afford to open her mouth. She has a big fan base, and she did it for the, you know, the less known artists. So, you know, I do kudos to her for that. I appreciate that. All right. So before we go to music break, question of the day is, what are your thoughts on the Confederate flag still being hung in South Carolina and in other states? Please tweet us at Stephen Knight Show SHO or go on our Facebook page, The Stephen Knight Show, The Stephen Knight Show, and let us know your thoughts. We'll be right back after this.
Somewhere else that's better for you. What is love if you're not here with me? What is love if it's not guaranteed? What is love if it just ups and leaves? What is love if you're not here no more? What is love if you're not really sure? But I know it's Something leaves. What is love? If
All right, our first guest is Corr Kendricks. He's a talented MC who has appeared on Empire, Fox hit show Empire. You may remember his character's infamous run-in with Taraji P. Henson's character, Cookie. Well, tonight he joins us to discuss his music and being a part of Empire. Please help me welcome Corr Kendricks. Welcome to the show.
How you doing? It's actually Corr Kendricks.
Welcome to the show.
How you doing?
So listen, I've been listening to your music, man. I mean, tell us about how you kind of got your start doing what you do and to led you up where you are now.
It started with actually me writing like journals and everything like that.
Okay.
So it was like it went
and
from
so you knew
writing. Yeah, writing journals to like poetry. And then, it turned into actually rap. So it was like everything that I feel or whatever, anything that I experience, whatever, most of the time I just put it into a song, you know, I get my best work from there.
Yeah.
And then, you know, me constantly working, you know, just doing everything that I possibly could, you know, it led me to, you know, different things. You know, thank God, you know, he pretty much lines up the stars and you just follow him. So I was pretty much following him doing, you know, if somebody gave me an opportunity or something, I'll jump on it. So it's like, I'm the type of person, I'm going to just go get it. You know, I'm not sitting around waiting for, all right, maybe this is going to happen. I work on one thing. If that don't work, you know, I'm not going to wait around and see the result. I'm going to go to the next thing and keep working. And, you know, I got to where I am now because of, you know, good friends and God, man. That's all it pretty much is. It's like, I've been through so much. So it's like, it's still unbelievable to me. Like, it still don't feel as real. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
I'm really living my dream now. So it's like, you know, I still got a lot of work to do, but it's just like, man, it's crazy.
Wow. Imagine what, you know, you kind of put in your songs, right? You take your personal experiences, put in your songs. Do you feel like your fans, they connect to you because they're about your music, what you're talking about?
Yeah, that's pretty much what it is. Pretty much like everybody that listens to my music, they either can connect to it in one way or another. Everybody can relate. So when I try to do my music, I don't try to do it like I'm trying to tell somebody else's story. I'm pretty much telling my story, and somebody in the world went through the same thing that I've been through, but in a different way. So it's like, all right,
if I can
put out a song about me in a bad relationship or something like that. Somebody else out there went through the same type of relationship, but just in a different way. It's like, man, like, I can relate to that. Like, yeah, that happened to me. This happened before. Like, everybody been cheated or used, whatever, so on and so forth. So it's just like, all about how you tell your story. My story is different from everybody else's, but we all can relate in one way or another.
Absolutely. So How did you get the platform to appear on Empire?
On Empire. Long story short, I pretty much Hakeem is my best friend. So, you know, I'm not saying that, like, you know, I'm riding any like hotel or anything, but, you know, that's been my boy for like 6+ years or whatever. So not even Hakeem Yaz, the greatest, Rashir Gray, actually, is my best friend. So when he got the opportunity, he already know Chicago is my hometown. So when he got the opportunity, he told me where it was and everything. I'm like, dang, yo, I gotta come out there. You know what I mean? If there's a slot open, let me know. I'm on the first play out there. So
right.
Like, man, I got you.
Yeah.
Yo. So, you know, he was working and everything, and, you know, he just brought me out, you know, just to give me a feel of it, a taste of it, see what's going on, and, you know, how to approach everything. I don't want to come out there and, you know, do something stupid and just mess up everything. So he's like,
right.
Yeah, come down, man. You know, we chilled, everything like that. So I came down, you know, got familiar with everybody. You know, everybody's great to be around. Taraji is like so many different good vibes and spirits all in one area. So it's like I got along with everybody. Everybody, you know, like me, so whatever. They was looking for a rapper that wasn't signed and that could act or whatever. And it was like last minute type thing. So I got a call from Jim Beans. And he's like, man, it's a part open, so can you get down here like at like 1 o'clock? I'm like, man, it's like 12:45, bro. Like, I'm on the north side of Chicago. That's all the way on the west side. I gotta take a a bus and a cab. I mean, and a bus and a train to get there. So, what the clock is just cut to close. So, he's like, let's try to get here about 1:30. So, I did whatever I had to do to get down there, you know. I auditioned. I did an audition tape. I went up with everybody else. In the meantime, they was asking other people if they knew people. So, everybody pretty much put me forward. Jesse, Yaz, Jim Beans, everybody pretty much was like, yeah, give it to him, give it to him. So, they let me audition. I got a call early in the morning, like, hey, congratulations. And I'm like, who is this? Like, did I win a sweepstakes or something? What's going on? And they're like, yeah, it's Fox. Congratulations, you got the part, whatever. So, you know, I just pretty much broke down and cried, man. It was, like, unbelievable. So
Yeah,
so, you know, after that, I got the script and everything, and it was go time.
Yeah. So how do you prepare yourself? Have you ever acted before, or was that your first gig?
Like, acting stuff before, like, a lot of extra stuff, background work. And then I did, like, a lot of plays and stuff when I was in high school, middle school. I used to, you know, try to, like, you know, I'm real laid back, goofy. You know, I like to do voices and imitate different movies and stuff. So it was perfect to, like, you know, try to do it. Like, I'm not that character at all. Like, I'm not a homophobic guy at all, nothing like that at all. Like, I don't judge anybody. That's not me at all. So most people get that, they get that mixed up. Like, oh, that's really him. Like, no, that's not me.
So how do you prepare for the character? I know I have the script. How do you, this person's not you. That's not how you are. How do you prepare, you know, this is a big acting role. Do you prepare for that role and the character?
Pretty much. Like, I pretty much had to put myself in Black Rambo's place. Like, if I was that way, how would I feel? Like, me to work for, you know, somebody, you know, like that and not like that. You know what I'm saying? Like,
if I was
to judge people the way they do. Like, I don't judge anyone by how they live their life or whatever, because I'm not a saint myself. So it's like, how can I actually put myself in that position and be mad at this person? So it wasn't even that.
Right.
It was, I had to channel my anger from something else. Not because of how he's living his life. I had to channel it as if he was like an enemy of mine trying to take over a company that you know, that I'm working for and that I probably could own one day, or not own, but, you know, get a high position in. So, like, now it's like, all right, who are you type? I mean, I got to get into this bag now. Like, man, who are you? Like, I'm not working for you. Like, what's up? Like, it's whatever. Like, so now I got to get into the character of being angry and, man, I don't want this. I don't like this boss. Like, it's pretty much, I don't like this boss. Like, I can't work good with this manager. Change my shift from this manager because I can't get along with this manager. Otherwise, I'm going to lose my job. So it's like, I'm not working with you. Like, what are you talking about? Like, no, I'm not good with that decision. So pretty much that's how I approached it. And, you know, me and Jesse are real good friends. That's like a brother of mine. I love him to death. So it's like, man, when I actually had to do the scene, I didn't want to do it with him. You know what I'm saying? I don't want to hurt nobody. I have a lot of family members that actually, that actually is like that. You know what I'm saying? So I don't want to, that's family to me. Jesse is family to me. You know what I'm saying? That's saying something to somebody you don't want to hurt. Like, I don't feel this way about you, but it's my job.
Right.
So
it's
pretty much, you know, he made it easier for me. We talked about it and everything. So it was pretty good. You know, we got it done.
Right. Exactly. And, you know, I think, also, by you playing that role, you know, it's representing people out there that do think that way. You know what I mean? So it also allows to have that conversation, you know what I mean, about being more accepting of people in general. So,
exactly.
But, so how has your life changed since being on Empire?
Man, words can explain. It's changed a lot, man. Like, you know, people notice me for my work. So, you know, that's a good thing, you know. That makes me feel good about, you know, that the type of work that I'm doing. You know, I've been trying for so long to do it. So it's like now I'm getting a little bit of recognition. It's not crazy big, but it's good enough. You know what I'm saying? I'm appreciative of whatever I get. So, you know what I'm saying? So it's like, dang, now people understand and they see me now. Like, all right, cool. That feel good. Now it's like, all
right,
I'm going to different cities now, going to places I've never been before. Like, you know. I'm doing shows with Yaz in front of 30,000 people at music fest. So it's like, it's been crazy, and I can just only thank God, man. It's been crazy.
Yeah.
It's been real crazy. So I'm just focused, and I'm just ready, really ready to buckle down, focus on this mixtape, get something going, you know, establish myself more as an artist and as an actor. You know what I'm saying?
Right. So you talk about your mixtape. Is that something that's upcoming for you, right? You know, in the near future?
Yes, in the very near future. I don't want to give no names on what the mixtape is going to be called. I got a couple projects in the works. So I do have Black and Gold that's coming. I can't even tell you when. But I got a mixtape coming out pretty much. The mixtape is just going to be me just pretty much jacking everybody beat and just going off on it just so y'all can, you know, get a taste of what I can do on other people's tracks. And then I'm going to hit y'all with something real good. But, you know, I've been putting out a couple of original things here and there just to give y'all a taste of where I'm going with things and everything like that. So, but it's not over. It's definitely not over.
What I want to do, I want to play one of your songs called Lord. I found it a lot today. Let's listen to it and then you tell us about it, okay? All right. This is Lord by Corr Kendricks. I think we're having some technical difficulties. The link is playing, but it's not playing. We'll get back to that. But tell us about that song. So when we do play, tell us about Lord.
Number two.
I'm sorry?
Hello, can you hear me?
Yeah, we hear you.
My bad. Pretty much Lord, it's pretty much my prayer to God, pretty much. It's like everyday thing that I go through, I'm pretty much telling God in my prayer. That's pretty much Lord. It's like pretty much, I'm trying to figure a good way to say this. All right, so let's say you go through a few things within your day or within your week. And it's like, man,
right,
I want to just give up this and that. But then, you know, when you pray, it's like, depending on how your religion is. Like, I don't have a religion at all. So it's like I'm not Christian, Muslim, or anything. I just have a very big faith that there is a God,
okay,
creator, whatever. So it's like, all right, this is my prayer to you. Like, you understand, you see everything, so you know what's going on. So it's like, okay, there's people out here that wants me, you know, either gone or want me to fail or whatever the case may be. So it's like, God, please just, you know, watch over me, protect me, my family, and everything, all the things that I'm going through, everything that I see, anything that's going on in the world, like, you know, hope for change and things like that, you know. So it's like, Lord pretty much tells everything that I experience, go through, you know, when I lost my brother, when he passed away, family situations, like I'm mentioning everything in there. So, you know, I just pretty much put my feelings out on the track. So It's deep. You just got to listen to it.
Yeah. And we're going to play it later on in the show, having some technical difficulties, but definitely want to play it because I listened to it today and I was like, wow, that's an awesome track. What is it that you want your fans to know about Corr Kendricks as an artist?
As an artist, I'm very passionate, very dedicated, very real, can be very blunt at times. I'm just, you know, my fans, I pretty much put yourself in. I want to put myself in your shoes. I want to be your voice.
Right.
If you can't be heard, let me talk. Let me speak for you. I can't, you know, I understand those that have been abused or abandoned or homeless before. Like, I've been there, you know what I'm saying? So it's like, I've been through so much. And for me to get here, it's like, you can do it too. And if I can show you the way, then, you know what I mean? Let me speak for you. Let me show you the way. Come follow me.
Yeah.
So my fans are just, I'm just here to, you know, love everybody for supporting and everything like that. So it's like, listen to the music. If you can relate to it, play it. You know what I'm saying? Play it. It might get you through your day. Because I know that a lot of times, a couple songs, it gets me through my day. Like, you know, a couple tracks I can listen to and it just make me want to go even harder. Like, yo, I can really do this. I can make this happen. I can make that happen. You just got to stay focused. Consistency always pays off. So That's me.
Let's try as
an artist.
As an artist. Listen to Laura. I think we have it up real quick. And just hold on to the line, okay?
See, they hate it. Keep me where I'm down, but I only elevated. I would never take defeat. Gotta grind until I make it. They just pray on my demise, but I'm patient. I'm just praying to the Lord. And I'm faded, sitting every day trying to find a way to make it. See, my babies gotta eat, and I'm never ever waiting. You just pray on my demise, but I'm patient. I'm just praying to the Lord. Please forgive me. Give me. Heard them cowards lurking. If they want me, come and kill me. I'll be posted on the corner with a hoodie and a hoodie. Never waiting for the money. I'ma grind and get a bill. Talking about the money, but I'm never seeing any. Fucking with the realists, all them killers rolling with me. Middle finger to the copper, cause they always fucking with me. I done had some situations, and I made it out of plenty. Lord, tell me, will I make it? Encounter with the devil in my life. Be trying to take it. Complications with my life. Trying to find a way to make it. Watch them boys up in the hood. Good at night, trying to take a load. See, they hate me. Keep me where I'm down, but I only elevated. I would never take defeat. Gotta grind until I make it. They just pray on my demise, but I'm patient. I'm just praying to the Lord. And I'm faded. Sitting every day trying to find a way to make it. See, my babies gotta eat, and I'm never ever waiting. You just pray on my demise, but I'm patient. I'm just praying to
every
the Lord.
Every day I be rich, never knowing will I make it. Blessed be alive. Gotta try to be the greatest. I'm forever gonna thrive. Gotta grind until I make it. Got the races in my face. Trying to find a way to make it, Lord. Accumulated haters, old friend became a few. Kept them screaming, they be riding, but they never ever do. Infatuated by the biddies, hope these cowards get a clue. Lord, see them blazing, see them blazing. Smoke away the pain, but the seconds never fading. I've been fighting through the rain, and I do it for my baby. But the real is the same when you coming up from nothing. Lord, see they hate me, keep me where I'm down, but I only elevated. I would never take defeat, gotta grind until I make it. They just pray on my demise, but I'm patient. I'm just praying to the Lord. And I'm faded, sitting every day trying to find a way to make it. See, my babies gotta eat, and I'm never ever waiting. You just pray on my demise, but I'm patient. I'm just praying.
I've been praying for my mama, and I'm praying for my dad. Praying for my fam, cause it's like we never happy. I can feel it in the air, know these cowards wanna clap me. They ain't never getting there, cause them shooters trigger happy. Lord, I've been dealing with the worst. Losing all my kin, got a riding in the hearse. I'm just hunting for this dream, let my fam, I put them first. It ain't nothing that compare, I just gotta make it work. Looking over shoulders and I gotta watch my back. I'm just ready for whatever, hope these cowards don't attack. I'ma send a couple wild, had them suckers running back. Lord, see they hate me, keep me where I'm down, but I only elevated. I would never take defeat, gotta grind until I make it. They just pray on my demise, but I'm patient. I'm just praying to the Lord. And I'm faded, sitting every day trying to find a way to make it. See, my babies gotta eat, and I'm never ever waiting. You just pray on my demise, but I'm patient. I'm just praying to the Lord.
All right, that was Lord by Corr Kendricks. I want to bring on another guest that everyone's excited about. We have one tonight. She's a dynamic artist who appeared on the first season of Empire as well. Her single, What is Love, is a fan favorite. We all love it here. We played it earlier. She joins us tonight to discuss her music as well and her experience on Empire. We welcome V. Bozeman. Welcome to the show.
Hi, how are you? Thank you for having
me. How's it going?
It's going good.
On.
I came in kind of late. I'm so sorry.
Oh, that's okay. That's okay. Listen, they were all waiting. Where is she? Where is she? I said, she's coming. She's coming. But
yeah,
I have you on here with Corr. Before we let you go, did you all ever work with each other while y'all were on set?
No, we didn't.
No, we didn't. We didn't work with each other, but I've seen her a few times around set.
Yeah.
Okay.
I remember you.
Yeah.
I just seen you at the music festival.
Well, reunion.
Right.
Yeah.
That
you
music
was
festival was hot as hell.
Yeah, you was rocking.
Thank you.
What music festival was that?
That was the African American Fest in Maryland, in Baltimore. It was amazing. Yeah.
Wow.
Live.
Wow.
There was a lot of people out there, good energy, beautiful black people, good soul music. You know how we do it.
Yeah. All right. Well, Corr, any closing remarks before we let you go?
No, man. I'm just, I'm actually out here camping with my kids and everything. So,
Oh, wow.
I'm just glad that y'all invited me. Thanks for having me. It's all much love. Hey, V. Hope to see you soon in the shower. You know, it's all love.
For sure. I'll be out there.
Hey, Corr.
If you come
Corr,
into
before
the
you go,
TV,
tell
everybody
to keep up with you.
Everybody, you can follow me on Instagram, Facebook, Twitter, all the same, at Corr Kendricks, Corr Kendricks. You'll not spell Kendricks, just something
wrong with you. Right.
Yeah.
All right, Corr, you take care, man. Appreciate it.
All right, y'all be safe. Stay blessed.
All right. B. Everyone says,
hey.
Oh, my God. We love her. You got her on the show. Now, listen, I first heard about you before Empire. I heard about you. You did a song with, is it Tim Bloom? A song called Till the End of Time?
Timothy Bloom. Yes, Till the End of Time.
Yeah. That's where I remember you from initially. And tell us about that, because you were all both nude in that video. Right?
Yeah, we were. We were. It was a nude situation. But for all the
right
reasons.
I was like shooting that video. Yeah, right.
But for,
yeah, yeah.
But for all the right reasons, I would never do anything that wasn't, you know, for the good of the music, something that
right.
you know, intense. So it was
exactly.
all for the right
exactly.
reasons, and I hope that it was translated that way. You know what I mean?
It was. It really was, yeah.
Yeah.
And we're going to play that song later on. But tell everyone, for people who, you know, only maybe know you from Empire, tell everybody about kind of how you got your start and led you to where you are today.
Well, I've been singing in the industry for a long time.
Mm-hmm.
I basically started professionally, like, you know, vocal producing people for Polo to Don. And while doing that, me and Timothy Bloom, you know, did that song you mentioned earlier, To the End of Time. And that's where I really started. That's where I got my initial, you know, fan base, core fan base from then
right,
from
yeah.
there. Before Polo to Don and that whole era, I was in girl groups. I was trying to baby face in a girl group. And that didn't work out. So in that interim, I started vocal producing and just redefining myself and my career and reestablishing, you know, who I was as a solo artist, because I was
right.
in groups for so long. And then
mm-hmm.
everything happened after that, after I just, you know, just stood what my purpose was and all of that stuff. It just changed from then on till the time happened,
wow.
and then everything else kind of had a domino effect, you know?
Exactly, exactly. So tell us about, you know, you being on Empire, and you know, you played the character who you were recording, What Is Love, and
mm-hmm.
Lucius told you to remember when your brother passed, because digging that emotion. How'd you become part of that show?
I became part of the show through Timbaland. I'm signed to Mosey Music, and when I was recording an album with him, the album was called Opera Noir, just to let you know that.
Mm-hmm.
But I did a piece called Race Jones that I had been sitting on for about a year and a half or so. And I just knew that once I showed this piece that something magnificent would happen.
Mm-hmm.
I just knew in my spirit. So that's why I was sitting on it for so long, because it had to be the right time, right place. You know, just it had to happen authentically. So when I got to Timbaland and we just had so many moments, I was like, yo, I'm going to show you this video that I did. Show him the video, and he just went ballistic, like, oh, my God, like, this is crazy on another level, you know. So he was like, I want to show Lee Daniels this video. He's doing this new series, you know, called Empire with the group this. And I was like, okay, cool. Showed it to Lee, and Lee, like, immediately called my management, was like, I need this girl. I need her on Empire. Because originally he was going to have, like, a girl group to be, you know, in that place as, you know,
okay.
the Lucius, well, I guess whatever girl Lucius signed, it was going to be a girl group. But he kind of
okay.
scrapped all that and just was like, I'm going to put her in, read for the part, and we're here now. We're here today.
Yep, exactly. You know what I like about this show is that it goes back to, like, real music, because, you know, a lot of what we hear on the radio, you know, there are a lot of talented artists, but you don't hear, you know, some of the best unknown secrets or hidden secrets, you know what I mean? We don't get to hear those on the radio anymore. And so this show kind of brings that back to the forefront, you know, hearing you. And I know you probably can't go anywhere now without singing What Is Love. How does it feel to have that song, have, you know, that's the song people want to hear from you? How does it feel when you go perform, they want to hear you sing that song?
I mean, it's amazing, because, and it's a blessing, it's humbling, and it's a God, it's a prayer answered, because my whole mission and statement as an artist It's not the celebrity side of it. It's really not, because that right. could come and go. It's really about touching the hearts and the souls of the people, and that song did just that. Jim Beams,
right.
The person that wrote the song and produced the song along with Timberland, he went to that place, and it just translated. It just touched the chords of the people, and love is a universal language, you know? So mm-hmm, that's mm-hmm. something that I think all human beings have asked at one point in time. What is love? Love is so different for everyone.
Right.
Love is so, you know, it's just people just have different experiences, different ideas. And I just think that song, even when I hit the high note, I'm singing love.
Mm-hmm.
Like, nobody mm-hmm. sings love like that, that word.
Mm-mm.
Even if you're Indian, if you're Japanese, if you're Egyptian, you don't know what I'm singing, but when you hear that love, you
yeah,
know what
yeah.
it is. And it just resonates.
Universal
you know?
Language.
So
yeah,
exactly,
yeah.
the universal language. So I just think that it was a prayer answer, and it was on such a big platform that it just hit, you know?
Right.
And we're here today, so, yeah.
Here today. Well, obviously you were doing, you know, a lot of great things prior to Empire, but how has
mm-hmm.
your career changed or been impacted by you being on the show?
Oh, tremendously. It impacted everything. It elevated everything. This is something
mm-hmm.
that an artist dreams to be a part of, to be introduced on such a big major platform that's powerful, that's effective. You know, Fox, the branding and marketing on this show alone is unreal. It's more powerful
right,
than any
yeah.
label than
yeah.
labels now. TV, people see
mm-hmm.
you, they hear you all over the world. Empire is all over the world. It's a cultural phenomenon.
Exactly.
So to be a part
yeah.
of it, this is history making. This is groundbreaking for an artist to be broken, you know, on such a big platform on a big level. So it's a prayer answered. Another prayer answered.
Absolutely. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
We love the prayer good answer. Definitely.
Okay.
What is next for you? I know you're probably working on some things.
What's next is second season of Empire. They're gonna do a lot of things with my character that I'm so excited about.
Oh,
I have
great.
This album out with
yes.
album coming out with Timberland. First single is called Smile. Actually, it just hit. It's about to hit radio sometime this week. Lord, I don't even
awesome.
Know the day. But sometime this week called Smile. It's going to be a really big song between him and I. And then, you know, following that will be my album. So there's just a lot of music
mm-hmm.
coming from me, and I'm just excited about it.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Well, definitely deserve it. Deserving of it. I mean,
yes, thank
the talent you.
You
have, you know what I mean?
Thank
so many
you
talented
so much.
People just get slept on, but you have that talent. I mean, you know, our co-host, Ms. Parker, she was so upset she was missing tonight's show. She had to deal with death in the family.
Aww.
But she said, I really want to talk
right.
to her. I want to talk to her, but, you know, she's a fan. We're all fans. So tell everyone
right.
where they can keep up with you and you know, all things of Bozeman.
Absolutely. You can find me on Twitter, @thatgirl_V, or Instagram, not that girl, but B Bozeman. I like to engage with my
mm-hmm.
fans and talk to them and, you know, just connect with them. So please visit
Absolutely.
Me.
Absolutely.
Yes.
Yes. And before you go, tell everybody like, kind of what I did with Corr Kendricks. What do you want your fans to know about you as an artist?
I want fans to know that I just want to touch your heart with music. I want to bring real music back to the hearts and the souls of the people, and just to make you feel good again and take you to that place. I'll never not give you my best and give you my heart and soul. I put my, you know, my heart in the line when it comes to this music thing. So just know that it's always authentic and 100% when I give you that, for sure.
Lee Bozeman, I thank you so much for joining us tonight, and I wish you all the best with your album, second season of Empire, and everything you embark upon. I know it's going to be great.
Thank you for joining us tonight.
Thank you so much. Thank you for having me. You have a wonderful night.
You do the same. Thank you.
Okay. Bye-bye.
Our thanks goes out to V. Bozeman for joining us tonight. And for more information, please visit us on visit our Facebook page. Now, we mentioned that she, I first heard about her years ago when she had a song with Timothy Bloom called Till the End of Time. Check it out. That was Timothy Bloom and V. Bozeman, Till the End of Time. So now we're going to Smith's Playlist. As you know, we see music from people all over the country want to be featured on the show. We thank you for submitting your music. If you want to be featured, email us at submissions@thestephenknightshow.com. Attach one or two MP3s. They must be edited for radio, meaning no cursing. And of course, your bio so we know more about you. And we definitely look forward to hearing your work. We want to see what's playlist. The first song is my I Love This Song right here. It's by Wale featuring Usher, Entire Matrimony. Check it out and enjoy Stephen's playlist.
If there's a question of my heart, you got it. It don't belong to anyone but question of my love. You got it, baby, don't worry, I got plans for you. Yeah, baby, I've been making plans. Oh, love, baby, I've been making plans for you. Yeah, baby, I've been making plans. Baby, I've been making plans.
My sister and the father, I made it. Look, I'll admit it, albeit pathetic, that I'm in my late 20s, still never been to a wedding. Guess the idea of that lobby empty, do not sit with me, well, it's not your fault they try to get me. Cause I'ma need your sales, cause I'm selfish, and I need you to myself. Trying to see you afloat, but don't want to see you sail, cause I failed. See you about to cry, cause when I enter they city, they leave without they pride. I'm sorry, are you staring at my comments? Fearing it's gonna always be you sharing me with all them. Wrong, how dare I say ignore them? Preparing for that day, I leave you here and switch you for them. It's hard, you know, temptation and all. It's out here trying to see if my relationship's strong. Get a place in the chart, so run away from your heart. Gave this music my all, nothing is sacred no more. I'm wrong. I'm promising you better though. Your friends saying let them go. And we ain't getting any younger. I can give them now, but
it's
I can promise you forever
though.
That's right.
You got it. It don't belong to anyone but you. Hey, if that's a question of my love, you got it. Baby, don't worry, I got plans for. Yeah, baby, I've been making plans. Oh, love, baby, I've been making plans for you. Baby, I've been making plans.
We really should have a room.
Baby,
I've
been making
plans
for you.
Really should have a room.
Yeah,
you have a new love. I'll admit it, let me be hypothetical. The day I find a woman, I'd probably be scared to share it. The idea of me finding love would run somebody off. But through my wall could use some plaques, but still I got a flaw. Brush you off. See, I'm kinda lost. Now I'm up in the club with a couple of moves on. From dark, good troubled heart. Went from falling in love to drunk and falling apart. It's hard. Trying to find some time to move on. When we lost our baby, I got shady. She got too dark. Sorry. And I thank you, baby, you strong. My ex before you married to you solo, I stay so long. Nah, good terms how that ended. But it surely put a dent on how I worry about this business. Off white picket fences, on flights with the children. On site stealing kisses, on off nights my intentions. But I plan to do it better though. But you still saying let it go. We ain't getting any younger. Women love me now, but in your eyes she forever though.
Baby, wow. It don't belong to anyone but you. Hey, if that's a question of my love, you got it. Baby, don't worry, I got plans for you. Yeah, baby, I've been making plans.
I love looking at you and the way God intended us. I'm talking about nothing all but a smile and a little bit of sweat when we made love. And it got me singing, oh, your body makes me go, yeah. I throw up my hands, say thank you to the man. Just to touch you is a blessing, and I'm glad I can. All I can say is a hallelujah, 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 pretty baby. You got me religious,
yeah.
Got me religious, got me religious. Ooh, and all I can say. Got me religious, got me religious. easily worth adoring you. Your voice in my ear, something like a choir of angels, even like Sunday morning. You got me singing. Your body makes me call, yeah. And I just throw up on my hands, say thank you to the man. 'Cause to be around you is a blessing. And I thank God I can, and all I can say is
Janet Jackson, her new song, No Sleep. Check it out. Listen, I want to thank you all for joining us tonight. I want to thank V. Bozeman and Corr Kendricks for joining us tonight. Listen, connect with us on social media, thestephennightshow.com. We appreciate you. Have a great week, and God bless you all.
You came here to party, gon' put your hands up. If you wanna get it started, gon' put your hands up. All my ladies in the front, all my thugs in the club. If you looking for some love, gon' put your hands up. Hands up, hands up, hands up, hands up, hands up. If you came here to party, gon' put your hands up. All my ladies in the front, all my thugs in the club. If you looking for some love, gon' put your hands up.
Now is the time to answer. What's next? With the Technical College System of Georgia, a quality education is affordable, offering courses that will transfer to a long list of four-year universities, and an opportunity to pursue a career in a high-demand field, where Georgia's Hope Career Grant could cover 100% of your college tuition costs. With 22 colleges and 85 campuses, meaningful careers start at TCSG. Visit tcsg.edu to learn more.
Has this ever happened to you? You put some money in a savings account with a great rate. But that promotional savings rate came crashing down. You deserve better. Take just 5 minutes and open a Capital One savings account online. You'll get one of the nation's best rates that's not a promotional rate. Welcome to Banking Reimagined. What's in your wallet?
For consumers only. Offered by Capital One N.A. member FDIC. Copyright 2017 Capital One.